Hi, everybody. It's Mark Bay here, the head of healthcare at Nurole. I can see participants increasing as we've just started the webinar, so I suggest we'll give it a couple of minutes to get that number up, and then we'll make a start. The first thing I ought to say to everybody is we're recording this session in order to share it with people who couldn't make it. So hopefully that's okay with everybody. So that's the first thing I'll say, and then we'll move quickly into an introductions once we get going. So we'll just wait for one more minute. And if you've logged in and wondering why we're staring at the screen, it's not saying anything. It's because we are waiting for a few more people to log in before we make a start. And actually, I can see the numbers stop now, so I think we'll make a start there. So hi, everybody. My name is Mark Bates at Nurole, and I wanted to welcome everybody to today's session on how to amplify the impact of commercial skills and strategy on NHS Trust Boards. And I'll be having a conversation today with Loy Lobo. And I've been very, very pleased to be joined with Loy. So Loy, do you want to introduce yourself first?
Thank you, Mark. And hello, everyone. I'm Loy Lobo. I'm a non-executive director at the Essex Partnership University NHS Trust. And I'm an executive with about 30 years experience in large corporates like Accenture and at BT Health. And I spent the last 10 years working with various health tech startups and doing a bit of teaching as well. Pleased to be here.
Thank you. Brilliant, thank you. We're really grateful for Loy's participation in this event. So thank you very much. You'll have seen that we were, hopefully you've seen that we were to be joined by Gaurav Batra as well. Sadly, Gaurav had to, I wasn't able to make it today, but I'm really, as I say, grateful. And we, and I suppose in many ways, it'll be useful and very useful for us to have a discussion. And I think I want to triangulate that with, people in the audience. Really, I really do encourage people to ask questions basically as we're talking, and hopefully this sparks discussion and sparks some thoughts, comments, and observations. Please feel free to share, and we'll raise questions throughout the conversation. So very briefly, I'm just going to go into an introduction about Nurole. So Nurole is an executive search firm. We are one of the largest firms of its kind, and it's solely dedicated to finding board-level talent for organizations up and down the country, across the world, across a multitude of different sectors and industries. And we are a membership organization. Some of you are members, and some of you may not be. And in fact, what I want to do is, in the poll section, you can see at the bottom of your screen, if you click on that, you may be able to find four things, which says, are you a non-executive at a trust at the moment? Are you a commercial board member looking for a NED role? Are you an executive at an NHS trust or any other? And if everyone could just put in one of those, tick one of those boxes, that would be really useful. Okay. That's wonderful. Thank you. Good. So hopefully some good reflections as we're talking, Loy, there. So before we get into the meat of the discussion, the aim of today is really for audience members to come away with, I suppose, an understanding of what commercial strategy means in the context of NHS Trust Boards, some ideas for expanding what the trust is already doing, and the types of board members that can be brought in to help trusts achieve their strategic priorities, particularly commercially. So Loy, over to you really, I guess, to begin with. Why are we having this conversation today? And part of that, what's changing in the NHS to require more consideration of bringing in commercial strategy and skills?
I was just going to say, looking at the profile of people on this call, there's probably a lot more experience in the audience. It would be good if they could weigh in as well into some of these questions.
Yeah.
I think this is actually an interesting paradox, because the NHS is moving away from the market model that was brought in over the past decade or so, with competition and commissioning at a micro level, to the integrated care systems and the integrated care boards, where we are now getting more into the model of collaboration with provider collaboratives. And some of the commissioning responsibility is being delegated down to the lead provider in the provider collaboratives. So in that sense, the commercial strategy and the emphasis is changing from competition to collaboration. And in many ways, that requires a much greater skill than the old market-based model. The challenge for commercial strategy is how do you engage with all of your partners in a meaningful way, and especially if you're the lead provider, how do you build that trust? And I think that's almost like a new habit that now needs to be acquired by many NHS managers. So I think that's the big challenge. I think where commercial experience can help, and certainly I reflect on my own commercial experience at BT, when we undertook very large programs, as an organization, large as BT was then and still is, we never undertook these contracts on our own. We had armies of partners and subcontractors that we worked with. And for the most part, everyone from outside looking in would think this was all BT. And the way some of my commercial and leadership colleagues brought that partnership together spoke of the maturity of the organization and the skill they had in creating these alliances and these partnerships, which were very complex. Something like the National Program for IT has been derided by many, but I sat there and observed my colleagues at work, and they were doing some fantastically complex and challenging work in a very stressful environment, and yet I could see some of the dedication and the skill they brought to it, and you know how you know, they did a good job of sometimes quite a bad hand that they'd been dealt with, and I learned a lot sitting next to them, observing them, talking to them, and learning from their experience, because then I took that into the work I was doing in BT Health, and the way we built up our partnerships for the next generation of BT services in healthcare, that was extremely valuable there. So I'm bringing some of that into my NHS role now too. So I just had a discussion on our commercial strategy last week, so this is quite interesting timing in terms of this talk today. And the realization is, you know, it's very, very clear. The emphasis is really on partnership. It's on building trust. It's on how we can bring together our various capabilities and resources to deliver patient-centered care. We have a generational opportunity now to deliver patient-centered care, because we realistically have the budget, the ability to join up budgets and allocate the right priorities across organizations, and to be able to negotiate that in a sensible way, you know, within the integrated care system. It's not going to be easy, but it's really interesting that now we have the opportunity to do so.
Yeah, no, thank you. I mean, there's a few really helpful to bring to life that BT example. And I guess using that as a benchmark, really, could you see in that experience that people from different backgrounds, people who are different functional and industry expertise, all came together to help solve a common a common problem? Was it the background of people that you worked with and their different skills and experiences that were brought together key to helping you solve some of those challenges?
I think I would say that's kind of different, because and that's where, you know, BT experience is quite different from an NHS board experience. Mm-hmm. In BT, we were mostly either techies or commercial people or lawyers. Yes, within that skill group, there was a lot of diversity, but there were very distinct skill groups. When you go on an NHS board, there's a much wider representation of skills that's required, from commercial to clinical to finance to quality to people and culture. So the skill representation with it is quite wide within a relatively much smaller group of execs and non-execs. I think the skill of the chair comes in to ensure that, you know, we're recruiting the right people to the board and that there's the right skill mix.
Yeah. What's the risk to trust boards who don't think in this way? What's the risk?
I think I haven't been there that long, but I think the biggest risk I see, sort of from my perspective, coming with a very strong background in digital. You know, I've done work of a digital transformation nature for over 3 decades.
Mm-hmm.
But because prior to this role, I was never employed by the NHS, although I worked in healthcare.
Mm-hmm.
People like me are still viewed as outsiders to the NHS.
Okay.
So if an NHS trust is looking for a non-exec with digital experience, I suspect there would be a preference to look for a clinician who has some digital expertise, because they would see that as a person who really understands the way the NHS works, its particular demands, and the role and the potential role that digital could play in its transformation. I think that presents a risk, because large transformation projects are incredibly complex and high risk.
Mm.
And given that NHS organizations need to, you know, some of them have adopted a new electronic patient record systems. And for many of them, it's been quite a traumatic process. I haven't been close enough to any of them to say, you know, what went wrong or what could have been better. But you hear stories that, you know, 50% of them really, really struggled and were almost disasters. And you hear that in the press as well, don't you?
Yeah.
I personally find that astonishing, because in my professional career, the transformation projects that my colleagues and I did, 9 out of 10 were successful. So to see a 50% success rate is, I think, you know, something's not right in the way things are happening there. And there are two patterns that I've seen emerge. I think one of them is digitization in the NHS is often seen as a digitization of a paper process into electronic form. And there, with that mindset, many opportunities for transformation are not imagined and can be lost for many, many years.
Mm-hmm.
I think the second issue probably more important, is that the effort required for change management to win hearts and minds, to train people, to ensure that they're supported in the new system, that is often underestimated. And that causes its own crisis and overhead after a big change like an EPR has been implemented. And I think these are the two big issues. I could think of three or four more as well. You know, I was involved with the NHS Innovation Accelerator, and we commissioned a study on, you know, why does it take so long for innovation of any sort to be adopted in the NHS, for it to go mainstream. And the big thread that came out was change management. It's every trust that you go to implement a change, it seems like you're starting all over again. So you don't get, you know, the benefits of scaling up.
Yeah, no, that makes sense. Thank you. There's a couple of comments that have come in, Loy, and what I want to do is quickly point towards two things so we can go back to them before I address these questions. One is around, I suppose, the impact of what you've said and the link to patient care and patient outcomes, which is one thing. And the other is budgets and how budgets inform and how budgets are informing discussion at board level, in particular in regards to transformation and how those two things work alongside each other. So let's put that to one side for a moment and we'll come back to it. We've got a comment or a question coming in, says, and I'll paraphrase this. So as non-executive directors, many of our health systems should be looking at investing more in preventative care to reduce avoidable acute intervention stroke admissions. So the business case is painfully difficult. Real cost savings are unlikely. Benefits are more likely to be released capacity to address backlog waits. So the question is, how can good commercial thinking help with this?
The challenge in health systems in the past has been that when you implement any sort of transformational change, you make an investment in one service and then some other service benefits. So I'll give you an example. In Essex, we've recently implemented a mental health emergency department in Basildon, right next to the Basildon Hospital, because we recognized that many people who were presenting into the Basildon A&E actually had serious mental health, mental illness. And although they were presenting in A&E, the primary cause for concern was mental health. So we've set up a mental health emergency department right next to the A&E. There's just a street dividing the two buildings. And we have a mental health nurse on duty in the main A&E at all hours. So they will speak to patients and their family where there's been a known history of mental illness, or the triaging clinicians are suspecting that there's a mental health issue that needs dealing with over here as well. And then those patients are then taken across to the mental health ED, and then they're treated there. So the mental health trust makes the investment in the mental health ED, but the acute emergency department benefits from it. In the past, this wouldn't have been possible. But it's because we're working together as an ICS, we are able to have those conversations to say, okay, if this is the right thing to do for our patients, then let's talk about how these budgets are allocated now and in the future. And having done that, we've seen impact within 90 days. It's clear that the new model is paying back. It's benefiting patients. If we were running net promoter scores, we'd be, you know, in the high 80s. People are really, really happy that, you know, they were in crisis and we gave them the right sort of intervention. The really interesting thing about the mental health ED is We conceptualized and designed and implemented it with the help of our patients. They were involved in every step of the needs assessment, in designing the space, in helping us figure out what were the workflows, what resources we needed where, what sort of signposting we needed, every aspect of it. We had our experts by lived experience informing the process. And we're going to be sharing some of that at a co-production conference we are to have in a few weeks' time.
Great, thank you. I mean, that neatly goes into the patient patient care aspect, isn't it? Because co-production is key, and the involvement of patients and service users is hugely key to that. So thank you. That's really helpful. One of the questions I've got here is, can you expand a bit on the missed opportunities in digitization? I don't know whether you want to just whilst we're close to that comment, whether we want to just quickly cover that bit off. So yeah. It was expanding on missed opportunities in digitization before we move on to the next piece.
Okay. Let's come back to that, because I'm sure I have an example somewhere. I need to give it some time to come back to me. We'll
sure.
come back
Thank
to that
you.
question.
Yeah, no worries. I'll write it down. Another question is coming in through from one of the members is how do NEDs get involved in innovation? So you're right to say that many innovation opportunities pass by unimagined because the scope of the digital change, for example, was unambitious.
Yeah.
What's your thoughts on that?
I think, well, I reflect on my own experience, and I share that freely. When people come to the board to present with various strategies, I've shared with them my experience of working with strategy at very large organizations. I teach innovation and innovation strategy at a business school, and I encourage my colleagues to, you know, bounce their ideas off me. And then many of them do, and then I get involved in the discussion, and my style is I ask them questions and then more questions, and then I start pointing them to resources, and I share with them some of my experience, and that's how they go away and they develop their ideas further and come back with maybe more questions, but often a vastly improved product of their thinking.
Yeah.
In but the other way I've been doing it is when business cases for service extensions or new services come before me for approval, I give them a full shakedown, particularly if I know if the services have opportunities for digital transformation, but they haven't considered them. So for example, one of the cases that came to me was for children's and adolescent psychology services that did not have a digital channel for access.
Okay.
I said, come on, in this day and age, you can't have a children's and adolescent service that doesn't have a digital access channel. And so you can't be procuring a service in this spec. Rethink it, you know, go to the market, do a consultation, try and find out, you know, what is available there. If you want, you know, my suggestions for what I think are the exciting things, I'll offer them to you. But, you know, you need to go and do your homework and come back with an improved spec. I'm not accepting this.
What
and
was
that's
the... Go on, sorry.
Yeah, for me, actually, that was a really powerful moment personally, because I've been sitting on the outside, you know, advocating for digital health and transformation all these years, and nothing ever changed.
Yeah.
And I just found it amusing that when you actually hold the purse strings and can say no, then things can start changing.
Yeah. I was going to ask actually, one of the questions in my mind as you're talking was how clinicians, how people who operate in a clinical capacity, whether it's at the front line, or you know, developing services or being directly involved in patient care, from it, how do you think it's been received having commercial talent on the board asking these questions? So I suppose really through a lived, perhaps a lived example of any thoughts, comments, or observations that you may have found in that example. Was there any pushback, any raised eyebrows, anything that you, or was it very much actually, I can see where you're going with this. I suppose my bigger question is the impact for clinicians on having people who come from, you know, outside of the NHS and helping them make decisions.
I heard later, 6 months after I joined, that the initial questions I was asking caused alarm for some people.
Interesting.
Because they were worried that, you know, do I actually know the NHS enough? Because I, according to them, was displaying some sort of naivety about the NHS in the questions I was asking. And perhaps that is so. I prefer to think that I know the NHS well enough for its dogmas and its beliefs, but that I'm not afraid to ask provocative questions that might cause people to at least think of a problem from a different perspective.
Yeah.
And I suppose it's a personal quality that I don't really care what people think about me, but I feel that I need to speak the truth as I see it, and then listen carefully to how people are responding. Often they might not respond. They might just go away thinking, shaking their head in disbelief, but not saying anything. But I've persisted. And then there's been a gradual shift over time that I think colleagues have realized that, yes, my perspective is different. I'm not from within the NHS. I don't know the depth of what they do, and I never will. But there is a benefit in it, because I can see their problems from a much higher level.
Yeah.
I've seen similar problems in other industries, and I've seen how those industries have solved such problems, and I can share that experience.
Yeah.
So, for example, you know, I'm sure colleagues on the call, my net colleagues, are completely familiar with the length of board papers and committee papers. They run into hundreds of pages. And I've been on a campaign to have a briefing document on top of every board paper that does not exceed 5 pages, that summarizes everything I need to know as a NED, including what decision is required, what are the key options that were considered for the decision and recommendation that's being made, so that I can come fully prepared for that meeting, having just read that cover note. We're not quite there yet, but
yeah.
I keep pushing for it at every meeting, and I keep coaching colleagues on how I would write that paper. And I take the time to do it outside of the meeting. Say, and that's gradually led to an improvement. I think one thing I've making clear every time is that I want our decision quality to be good, and for that to be good, authors of papers do need to do their homework really well, not just in writing the paper, but in summarizing it in a way that supports the decision process.
Yeah. Thank you.
Coming back to the question that you asked, that was asked about missing opportunities for reimagining or, you know, going beyond mere digitization of paper. Most electronic medical records are designed to be departmental systems of record. And the communication that then emanates from it is in the form of a letter. I've come across very few systems so far, and they may have changed in recent years, but it's very difficult to truly get a patient-centered view out of a hospital system. Yes, you can do that in GP systems. It's very difficult to get that out of hospital systems. And then hospital systems don't merge or share their information very often with community and mental health systems or primary care systems. And the few implementations that we've had of shared care records are, again, sort of like an accumulation of information and sometimes a bit of an overload of information to really support decision making. And I think we are missing something here, because if this were a commercial organization, they would have been using a CRM like Salesforce, which, and I know a thing or two about Salesforce. So if they were calling up a patient or a patient called them up, it would bring on the screen, okay, who is this person? What is their medical history? What was their last diagnosis? What is their last contact with the service? What care are they currently under? What's their favorite color? What's their favorite animal? Everything would show up on the screen. And if the person started saying, okay, I've got a complaint about this, that, or the other, and you start typing up the complaint, you start giving prompts, say, you know, direct the person to this service, offer them this advice, share this information with them, call them in for an assessment, whatever, that information will start appearing on the screen. I don't think any of our EMRs do that.
Interesting.
And that's what I mean, that we are missing these opportunities, because it's not good enough to maintain, to have these systems of record. They need to be systems of action. They need to be systems that positively support and contribute to creating a better patient experience, and they should be easy to use, so they're a great experience for the person who are using the system as well.
Yeah, that's really helpful, thank you. As you're talking there, one of the other contributors talked about, when assessing or making decisions from a budget perspective, shifting the conversation from cost to value is really, really helpful. Do you think that has some impact, or that moving that from A to B would have some impact on the ability to make decisions in that way that you've just described, or making it easier to make those decisions, so those opportunities aren't missed?
Oh, totally. I think two aspects on the budget. I think the first thing is every service transformation budget needs to include the budget for change management. I find that it's often not included. So just to make sure that we are comparing everything correctly, the budgets need to be complete. It may mean then that some of the business cases don't really stack up, and we shouldn't be doing those projects. And that's fine. You know, it's better to do fewer projects, but do them well, and, you know, drive them to completion. The second is when considering the value of the business case, not just a cost benefit analysis, it's looking at the financial and the health outcomes that are achieved, and to calculate, you know, what some people also call the social ROI. Now, that's not easy, and it's often difficult to do with a spreadsheet. In my own experience, I've used specialist modeling tools to calculate social ROI and to calculate complex business cases, because the interrelationships and the feedback loops and the reinforcement loops that drive the benefits of some of these cases, it's very hard to represent them in a spreadsheet. And if it's hard to represent them, then it's harder to even communicate the idea that this is a sensible thing to do. Now, that's a specialist skill. It's worth acquiring. I have pointed the strategy director and research director in my organization towards acquiring those skills. And they should, because every other high value industry that I've worked in and I provide consulting services to, such as, you know, pharma and oil and gas, they use these tools and techniques because, you know, they have to make investment plans for 10 years, 20 years, 25 years. You can't do this in a spreadsheet.
Thank you, Loy. That's really helpful. I'm just conscious of time, and I just consider we've discussed some of the key aspects around what it means to be commercial within an NHS Trust context. Spending the last 5 minutes going through, I suppose, the different kinds of people that may constitute different or commercial. So I guess the question is, or could be, you know, if a board has started to identify that there is an imbalance in the commercial and the clinical experience on their board, what do you think their next step should be?
I know that on our board, we try and maintain some sort of like a skills matrix that the chair does that. And then, you know, depending on where we are as an organization, we need to boost those skills. One of the big challenges in our trust was to develop a culture of learning. And so we went and sought out a board member who had that relevant experience, and, you know, turns out he came from academia, didn't have NHS experience, was not commercial, but, you know, had very deep roots in academic research, especially around creating a culture of learning. And so that's what we went for. We have two upcoming needs for NEDs, as you know, some of my colleagues are coming to the end of their term. But we are not seeking a like for like replacement. We're looking at, you know, how the emphasis in those particular roles has changed, and whether there is a need for looking at different skills, and we haven't completed all of our deliberations yet. But even when we're looking at roles with clinical skills, we've realized that because of the collaborative nature of the relationships that we need to build going forward, whether we can find someone with clinical experience who may have then gone out into industry, into some other role, who then has, you know, appreciation of both aspects of what needs to be done. So, for example, I know of lots of doctors who then go off and do an MBA and then go off to work at McKinsey or work in the pharma industry or something else, and see if there are some candidates of that sort of profile who'd be interested in an NHS net role. So we're trying to say, look at what is that mix of skills that could be more suitable for us over the next 3 to 6 years as we attempt to fill these roles.
Thank you. There's just to mention on the questions that I've had so far. So the first one was asked by Andrew Prince. I just forgot to name check these as they came through, Lois, so I just wanted to make sure I did that. So And then the one, the second one was from David Levinson around innovation. And then I've got another one from Howard Goodborn, who says, whilst the NHS wants to get commercial input, when one provides a different approach or perspective, they're actually unwilling to change, saying that's not the way that we do it in the NHS, pointing back to one of your reflections. Yeah. We've interviewed dozens of board leaders in new role through our podcast, and one of the common themes they talk about is that healthy tension. When you get that kind of situation, how do you make that a healthy tension?
I think I was on a course with David Levinson, and we remarked that the NHS is probably one of the few places where cash is not fungible.
I'm sure he's smiling behind the screen there. I can't see him, but
and that's one of the peculiar ways in which some NHS budgets work. Not all of them.
Hmm.
It's a difficult one because, you know, you work very hard to create an annual forecast. Well, the finance team does. And then you literally have to land that on a postage stamp. You know, deficits are frowned upon. But you can't, the optics of a surplus are not very good. It means that you haven't, you know, spent all that money on services. That's a terrible thing to do. And in the middle of that, you have to deal with all sorts of surprises. No other business works like that. I was quite outspoken in the feedback I gave as part of the Hewitt review to say that, you know, ICSs and trusts need more latitude. And one of the recommendations was that the more mature ICSs would get that latitude. But I don't know if anything has been approved yet by the health secretary. But it was definitely there in the report. And to an extent, colleagues are right. That's not the way the NHS does things, but that's not the way the NHS ought to be accepting as the way to do things in the future. And so that's the pressure I bring to bear in the conversations I have either at my trust or I'm on the Finance and Investment Committee of the ICS as well. No, that's slow progress. But, you know, I've made my aims and intentions clear. They may or may not be fulfilled, but it at least sets the... It gives people the framework to which I ask my questions. So what's happened, at least as a result of that, is many of my colleagues have learned quickly the kind of questions I ask. So they come prepared with the responses. So it means that if they have to prepare the response, then they need to think through the implications of what they're going to say. So that itself is beginning to push thinking in a slightly different direction from where it used to be.
Yeah.
Because I'm not giving up on the questions.
Yeah. Thank you. Juliet Armstrong, who's an attendee and has written, she's been on a similar mission in the length of the board papers. And look, it's something I've heard consistently in many years of recruiting at this level. And she says the trust that she's involved with has recently introduced a cover sheet summary template, saying it's massively improved the quality of the discussion, the links between committees, and has focused the execs' minds on the key issues and the next steps. Would you say that's an example of more commercial thinking at board level?
Yeah, definitely. Because I was speaking to a friend of mine who's been on the boards of companies like, you know, BAE Systems and Nike and others. And he said, our entire board pack never exceeded 50 pages. And we were taking much bigger decisions.
Yeah.
And so what he shared with me was what they call a stop memo, which is the situation, a description of the situation, the target outcome you wanted, the options that you considered, and the proposed way forward. That was 3 pages, maximum 5 pages. That was it. And if every decision came with a stop memo, that's all a board really needs. You know, everything else can be posted in the public domain for full disclosure to say, these are all the supporting papers and this is the 80-page report for this and the 50-page report for that. That's all very well. But, you know, so long as the stop memo summarizes everything and the person who's producing that memo says that everything that's material to the decision is contained in this memo and I take responsibility for the accuracy and its completeness, then the board has a good starting point. And then it takes away the incentive to hide some crucial detail on page 56. And then, you know, you don't, as a NED, you don't want to be faced with some crisis 6 months down the line. Some person says, but it was there in that report. You were informed. Why didn't you read it?
Yeah.
And so we read the entire 600 pages that we receive every time.
Yeah. And I guess reflecting back on that, you know, one of the key things that might prevent more commercial people coming onto the board is them saying, look, you know, I've seen board papers in the public domain. That's too much for me to read.
Yeah.
And you could argue, therefore, that's a potential limiter to new talent coming into boards.
Oh, totally. We, you know, I know of a trust that had a very good commercial net come on the team. And after two meetings, that person said, hey, this is not for me. It takes too much time.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think I've, over my 10 years of recruitment, I probably heard that more than one occasion as well at Loy. Another comment here, just again, conscious of time, but you mentioned the ICS in the context of which trusts operate within the integrated care system is hugely important. And there are new opportunities, but also huge pressures for NEDs. And the question is, who is your master?
Yeah. It's still being worked out, I suppose. When I sit as a provider representative on the ICS finance committee, there is obviously a conflict of interest that needs to be managed there, which you know the chair does brilliantly, and the ICS team handle it really well, but it does take time. And I find that I'm now on four different committees. I had to have a conversation with the chair that, you know, we need to bring on more board members because I'm doing the work of two NEDs at the moment. I don't like doing it, but I've cut back on my site visits for now until, you know, someone can come in and sort of take some of my load away.
Yeah. Which I guess highlights the real, you know, a real live example of needing more, you know, people like yourself on boards to ask those critical questions.
Yeah.
Loy, it's 10 to 6. I suggest that we close, that big move to a close on the discussion. I know that others involved in the call would you know, absolutely have this conversation for far longer. But I think in the interests of, you know, capturing the essence of the conversation, I think we've done exceptionally well. So I just wanted to say thank you, Loy, for sharing your thoughts and comments and observations. Hugely helpful. And we are publishing a white paper, your contribution and others that we've spoken to on this very, very important topic. Once again, I really do value your thoughts and reflections within that. If there's any questions that any of the attendees want to ask, feel free to either jot down and we can answer later, or feel free to pick up with me and have a conversation. I'm very much interested in this topic, as you can see, and I value conversations and would love to have an opportunity to meet with attendees and have that conversation. And just to say, thank you once again, Lloyd, for your valuable time. It's been hugely helpful and very, very informative. So thank you.
Thank you for asking me. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.